why Beethoven has such strong appeal to us even today. We always talk about how genius is Beethoven. Maybe it's more about a human existence, an artistic production. That is what I like to think of him. A man who composed in very different ways throughout his life, who experienced very hard moments. My question is why I go over and over on Beethoven. He's such a strong presence in my personal artistic life. It's probably because his music is so varied and at the same time so deep. It's not just about musical effects. We all know Beethoven can move from the serious to the light, carefree even mood, touching sometimes on the trivial even. It's also about forms and it's about genre. Beethoven was a very cultivated and curious artist, and in his works we find a diversity of inspiration, which is probably incomparable to other composers. Let's take, for instance, the Bagatelle. Bagatelle in Italian means something really not important, something light, has a touch of irony sometimes on it. So Beethoven composes Kleinigkeiten, small things, but in these small things there's a thickness of thought and a feeling that it's quite amazing. Bagatelle 1 and 3, the ones I play, are both very intimate in character, singing. Both are andante, cantabile. One is compiacevole, in Beethoven's words, that means delightful. The other one, the third, is grazioso, gracious. I decided to play the two pieces on two different instruments of this beautiful collection. One is the Brodmann, 1827, about the time of the composition of the Bagatelle. The other one is the Quante, end of 18th century, although it's some 30 years before the composition, in its clear and light features. It underlines the lightness of a third Bagatelle, which was written by Beethoven in 3-8 and not in 3-4 like the first. More than that, I decided to put a register of moderator, which is a cloth that goes between the strings and the hammers and it damps the sound throughout the piece. So we'll have this very inspired and overworldly sound. In the first Bagatelle, we have more pastoral character. But to that, which I find very interesting, there are incursions into the free fantasy style with improvised elements. And Beethoven, we know, was a great improviser. And it's more rhapsodic in style altogether. And the later Brodmann, it stages better the different voices of this beautiful piece.
Thank you.
First time I played on a fortepiano, I felt like I was actually living in this allegory of the cave by Pluto, and I was playing, of course, the prisoner. So this prisoner lived chained in a cave, believing that the shadows cast inside the cave by the outside world were reality. But one day he break free, and on the way out of the cave he discovers the real world, the world of ideas. And that's what fortepianos has been for me. They are my world of ideas. The first time I played on a Viennese piano of this kind, well, I cannot forget this sweetness of the sound, the sensitivity of the keys. It changed completely the way we understand music, the way we approach to performance, and it challenges us to rethink completely our practice. And of course, once you get out of the cave, you cannot go back in. The sound properties of this instrument deeply influence the way we play, just as they did in Beethoven's time. But the same features impact differently on different pianists, and each pianist develops a personal way to interact with an instrument. This project at Schloss Weissenbrunn has this aim: to make the intimate bond between a piano and his pianist visible and heard. And that provides a special insight into this complex interaction which took place and takes place also today between performers, their instruments, and their worlds of ideas. This piano will sound completely differently according to the pianist who is playing it. And that's because given the inside properties of an instrument, it is up to the pianist to bring them out and to imagine the musical effects which they could inspire.
Thank you. Ich finde es sehr besonders, hier zu sein, in Schloss Weißenbrunn, bei diesem wunderschönen Brodmannflügel. Denn hier kann man sich relativ gut ablösen von der harten Realität da draußen und auch von den Vorurteilen und vorgefertigten Ideen, die man im Kopf hat von der Musik. Man kann einfach mit dem Instrument in Dialog treten und suchen. Und das ist für mich ein sehr wichtiges Wort. Also suchen und Dialog. Denn wenn man versucht, etwas Vorgekautes aus einem Instrument zu fordern, kommt meistens nicht das Beste dabei raus. Und ich habe es bei der Aufnahme sehr genossen, eben dem Instrument Fragen zu stellen, um manchmal klare Antworten zu bekommen und manchmal auch Fragen zurück. Und das ist wirklich das Besondere an historischen Instrumenten, dass es jedes Mal ein bisschen anders ist und gleichzeitig ist man zurückversetzt in die Zeit der Komponisten und in den Geschmack und Klang und die Klangfarben von diesen Komponisten, wofür sie geschrieben haben und womit sie geschrieben haben. Also an diesen Werkzeugen haben sie ja gearbeitet. Und das ist für mich eben eine große Besonderheit. Und das gibt es nicht an vielen Orten auf dieser Welt.
Thank you. I'm sitting at this beautiful 1820s Broadwood, exactly from the time of Beethoven, the kind of instrument that he himself would have played on. And it's really inspiring to play Beethoven's music on these instruments. It's, if I were to compare this to playing on a modern piano, this is much more of a duo. It's really about hearing something, taking something from the instrument, being inspired by the instrument, being even taught something about the music, as opposed to a modern piano, which is, let's say, almost like a product of industrialization, a mass-produced, beautiful machine that works and does everything you want, but it has a limit to how much it can teach you about the music that was not written for it, like Beethoven's music that I was just very fortunate to play on this instrument and also on an early instrument. One of the very exciting things for me about playing on instruments from this time is that they're so different. There are many differences between the instruments, but also within each instrument. For example, every register is different. You're starting from somewhere in the low register with sounds like that of a cello. And ending up with something more like a flute. And in addition to that, at this time in Vienna, in Austria, in Germany, builders like to add as much variety as possible to the possibilities, to the sound possibilities of the piano. So I have below the instrument five pedals, which produce all sorts of different effects, which I try to use in the performance of the B minor Bagatelle. One of them is a bassoon stop. So if the regular sound is more like a cello, with a bassoon stop, it's got this very nice nasal quality. And then there is two different moderators. And of course a damper pedal. And many other possibilities. And of course combining these gives you almost unlimited number of colors you could play with. And that's really inspiring for me as a keyboard player. Thank you.
I feel very, very fortunate to be here and to be able to try these wonderful pianos in this collection. We pianists and fortepianists are always having the kind of challenge to adapt to different kind of instruments. First of all, this repertory, what we are working on, what we are performing, is of course very different to play on a modern piano and on a fortepiano. We always think of the fortepiano as the kind of father of our modern pianos, but it's actually really more than that. Not only because the instrument works very differently, but also because it teaches and challenges you to do different things and to look at the music on a very different way. Having the fortune to try here even different Viennese pianos can be very surprising, also because the difference between historical pianos, historical Viennese pianos, can be so big, just as between a modern piano and a fortepianos. Just to mention the most important differences between a modern piano and a fortepiano, the length of the notes will determine absolutely your tempo and your flow, and also in a way your energy and your boundaries in the dynamics. Of course, Beethoven was very famous about a singing note and having such a beautiful legato like nobody else of the time. And I think that was also the part how he challenged the evolution of the keyboard instrument.
Thank you. Ich erlebe gerade eine sehr inspirierende Erfahrung mit einem Hammerflügel von Brodmann aus dem Jahre 1827. So ein Instrument hat Beethoven benutzt. Die sechs Bagatellen Opus 126 von Beethoven, das sind die letzten Klavierwerke von ihm. Ja, das sind zwar kurze Stücke, aber die haben wirklich sehr geheimnisvolle, spezielle und tiefe Inhalte. Und das ist jetzt unsere Aufgabe, meine Aufgabe als Pianist, das zu recherchieren, zu entdecken. Damit ist ein Versuch verbunden, wie man das Ganze versteht. Und zwar in Verbindung mit einem historischen Hammerflügel. Ja, man muss das hier auch sagen, dass Beethoven in seinem ganzen Leben verschiedene Hammerflügel benutzt hat. Hammerflügel aus Wien, wie diese Brodmann Hammerflügel, oder ein Erard aus Paris, aber auch ein Broadwood aus London. Also diese unterschiedlichen Klangwelten waren sicher für Beethoven sehr, sehr wichtig und haben auch die Instrumente einen direkten Einfluss auf seine Komposition. Wie fühlt man sich jetzt als Pianist? Wie läuft es, wie man auf so einem Hammerflügel spielt? Dieses Instrument ist extrem empfindlich. Jede kleine Berührung, jedes Touché sofort erweckt und provoziert neue künstlerische Impulse, neues Timing, neue Phrasierung, neue Balance. Auch wir haben so verschiedene Pedale hier. Das alles zusammen sozusagen zu koordinieren und eine organische Einheit zu finden in diesen Bagatellen, das ist keine einfache Aufgabe, aber man lernt unglaublich viel, auch mit sich selbst, mit dem Hören, mit dem Spüren der Finger oder der Hände. Es ist immer ein Prozess von sich selbst neu quasi zu erleben und das neue, aber alte Instrument. Insofern ist es eine unglaubliche, spannende Interaktion mit sich selbst und mit dieser Musik. Und natürlich für mich die Musik von Beethoven, auch diese Bagatelle, provozieren viele Geheimnisse. Wenn wir jetzt die Bagatelle Nummer 5 nehmen, wo Beethoven schreibt quasi Allegretto, es ist schon für mich eine Frage, was er dadurch meinte. Einerseits Allegretto, es ist etwas zwischen Andante und Allegro. Und da muss man sich entscheiden, mit welchem Charakter man dieses Stück spielt. Es kann Richtung Allegro gehen, Richtung Andante. Auch Leopold Mozart schreibt, was ein Allegretto ist. Und er beschreibt das als etwas auch Scherzhaftes, etwas Lebendiges. Und vielleicht stellen wir uns manchmal nicht genug diese Frage, was überhaupt ein Allegretto ist. Also das ist nur ein kleines Beispiel mit einer Frage, von diesem Notentext für mich als Pianist als Aufgabe, wie man das Ganze versteht. Und da sind, kann man schon sagen, sehr viele Schwierigkeiten verbunden, aber ich finde gerade das sehr inspirierend und man lernt dadurch sehr, sehr viel.
Thank you.